Good afternoon. This is the first of our Talking Personally programmes. Each week at this time, my ITV colleagues, Michael Barrett, Andrew Gardner, Eamon Andrews, Sandy Gall and Judith Chalmers, will be talking personally to a guest of their choice. Today, my choice comes from the other channel, by courtesy of the BBC. He is none other than Sir Robin Day, the BBC's great man, knighted in 1981. He's been for many years and is certainly now the best political interviewer on both television and radio. He began with Independent Television News, one of those who first made it a power in the land. Then he did the same with Panorama, and he is now, of course, the star of Question Time and Radio's World at One. I don't see him myself very often at general election nights or budget days, but they tell me he's usually adequate. He's 58, and he's invariably hale and hearty, although after a painful fall in Switzerland today, he's perhaps just chiefly hearty. What were you doing at your age, going to Switzerland and getting crocked?
Well, on the subject of my age, I'm 59, actually, not 58, but I know that you always...
Flattery wouldn't hurt at the start.
I know that you always put great store by accuracy. I was skiing, I was traversing, if you know what that means. That is to say, moving across a rather bumpy slope, and I fell with some considerable impact and unfortunately fractured my pelvis, and it's beginning to mend, but don't ask me to move about. Don't provoke me too much during this interview to move.
Will you do skiing again?
That is a most depressing question, and I'm sorry you should have put the most depressing question so soon in the interview. I don't yet know. I hope so, because my dream has always been to go skiing with my two small boys who are aged, who will be next year aged 10 and 8. But I'm not sure whether I ought to now, because I feel a bit of a Charlie at my age, as you so rightly say, in my 60th year, sort of being in this condition.
Now, why did you go into television?
Oh, because I needed work, and I was unemployed, and I was getting on. You see, I went into television when I was 33, that is to say, usually at the age that people retire from television nowadays. I went into television after I'd been at the bar. I was a failure at the bar.
Oh, no, you weren't. Now, come on, you won a lot of prizes.
Well, only they were just sort of scholarships and things, but in practice that was a very difficult time for the bar, and I did reasonably well, but not well enough, nor did I think I was going to be a very distinguished barrister. I might have been adequate in some respects. But anyway, I ran out of money and decided I wanted to do something else, and I went to America, and I went into television because a friend rang me up. He's now a high court judge. He rang me up, and this was in the summer of 1955, and he said, there is a notice on the board of Gray's Inn from something called Independent Television News, who are looking for something called a newscaster. Do you know anything about it? I said, no, it sounded interesting, and I asked for the application form, and I was given an audition, and much to my surprise, I was then given a second audition, and I was offered the job of newscaster because they were looking for people who... They advertised in an inn of court because they wanted someone who could speak and who could had some sort of could talk on their feet, rather than a lot of writing journalists who had not been very successful in the auditions.
So what kept you in? Was it the success or was it the money?
What kept me in
television?
Oh, it certainly wasn't the money. I mean, my initial salary was $1,000 a year. That was in 1955. It went up from $1,000 a year to, I think, $1,500 a year in 1956. And it crept slowly up, but very modestly up. And I don't think that you would want to know what my earnings are now, but they're really, I'm sure, chicken feed compared to yours, and to a well-paid professional man. I stayed in it because it was a new venture, something totally new, television journalism. This is one of the reasons I stayed in it and was reasonably successful, because nobody else had ever done it.
You did once think, perhaps you thought more than once, of changing. You once applied to be Director General of the Independent Broadcasting Authority. Do you think you have administrative skills as well as your others?
Yes, but I never had a chance to develop them, so that's a statement of total and irresponsible vanity. I was always very good at organising before I became a talking communicator, and I would like to have held a position of responsibility. I was considered both for the Director Generalship of the IBA, this was in the early 70s, and later for Director Generalship of the BBC about 4 or 5 years ago, when I was asked to apply for that. But of course the devastating question came after I'd been very impressive. This was at the BBC interview, when one of the Board of Governors said, Mr. Day, as I then was, Mr. Day, what experience have you had of running an organisation with a turnover of £300 million and with a staff of 28,000? And I had to say none whatever, but with my courage in both hands, I said, that is precisely why I'm applying, because you don't want the sort of fellow who's had that experience. I mean, this was quite ingenious, but it didn't go down as well as I would have hoped.
So that was just one very minor failure. What programme that you've been on actually do you think has fulfilled you most, made most use of your skill, interested the public most, given you, in a sense, more self-satisfaction than any other?
Difficult to say. I would have thought, I have to give you two answers to that, because I've never been asked it before. I think off the cuff I would say two answers. First of all, the early days of ITN, when we were really creating a new form of journalism and a new method of democratic communication, both with the 16mm camera and with the enlivened coverage of news to combine vigour with responsibility, which was the ITN theme. And secondly, I would have said in the 60s on Panorama, where I moved after I'd been with ITN, when I used to do a lot of film making all around the world, live interviews with leading politicians, discussions, and this was a very varied texture of journalism. And in those days, of course, unlike now, Panorama was almost the only serious weekly programme. Not the only, but it was the main weekly serious programme and had a tremendous standing.
You do a lot of radio now. What particular skill does that require?
Well, it's an entirely different from television, and I didn't know whether I was going to be any good at it at all. But they've been kind enough to renew my contract on The World at One. It's marvellously fast. It's far faster than television. You go into the World at One studio and you think you've got your programme all lined up, and within 2 minutes the thing is upside down. You're talking to someone on a ship in the Gulf of Aqaba or something.
Some television programmes are upside down too.
Yes, but if I may say so, I think you would be the first to admit that with the advent of colour and the elaborate techniques which you now have in the admirable News at 10, on the whole the programmes aren't quite as fast and flexible as you would sometimes like. I mean, they are on election night when you're geared to the whole live thing, but the running order changes and everything else like this. Admittedly, sometimes you get a hitch in News at 10, and that is when you come into your own, because you're very good at dealing with hitches.
I don't seem to remember those occasions.
Well, that is your skill in putting it behind you.
Well, now, you have developed the most distinctive interviewing technique. What is it based on?
I don't think it is based on any conscious design. I suppose that having been a member of the bar, I used to sit behind some of the great cross-examiners of the time, in their cases, such as Sir Hartley Shawcross, as he then was, Mr. Gerald Gardner, as he then was, and the barrister to whom I was fortunate enough to be a pupil, who is now Lord Justice Lawton. And one saw the technique. And this, of course, is not the sort of technique of films and television, the bullying cross-examiner, not at all. This was the probing, this was the carefully prepared cross-examination, with one of the main lessons being that you don't ask a question to which you don't know the answer. Sometimes one falls into that area and one is often clobbered.
Did you do that?
I have done that once or twice, yes. You mean at the bar or on the television?
At the bar.
I think I did once. I remember an elaborate cross-examination of a policeman, asking him how his advance towards the accused could not have been known to the accused, and because of his large hobnail boots, which were he admitted he was wearing. And I thought, and how do you think you didn't know you came? He said, because I was riding my bicycle. And it's a collapse of a young barrister.
Do you think that your technique gets the best out of everybody? Isn't it possible that sometimes people clam up on you?
Well, this has often been said by people who prefer a rather sort of soft soapy technique and a too chatty technique, on the grounds that they think that they will get more out of somebody like that. I don't think this is necessarily so, because leading public figures from the Prime Minister downwards, if they want to say something, they're going to say it. If they don't want to say something, they're not going to say it. And this is a matter for them, irrespective of whether the whether the interviewer is a smarmy interviewer or whether he is what you would call a tough interviewer. In any case, I never, contrary to legend, I never, if I'm interviewing a leading politician, I don't approach them in an aggressive way. I may make my questions shorter than other interviewers, but that is just a style of speaking, because I think it is my duty to put things on behalf of the public rather than to have a fashionable conversation with them.
Is it possible to be politically unbiased in television?
I don't think there are very few people who are unbiased in themselves, but I think it is quite possible to conduct one's programmes in an unbiased way. Indeed, I have done so, and so have you, if I may say so. I know some of your political views, Alastair, but not all of them. I don't know your views on individual issues, which I haven't discussed with you. But I can honestly never remember you expressing expressing an opinion in the course of a programme in a way which showed you were showing bias. You were reflecting an attitude.
You know, you're being very generous indeed today, Robin. Just going on some of the prime ministers that
yes.
you have interviewed.
Yes.
I mean, would it be true to say that people like Gaitskell, he wasn't a prime minister, but Gaitskell and Heath were actually trying to change things in this country, but couldn't express themselves at all well to television or indeed to you, and that, say, Macmillan and Wilson weren't trying to do very much, but expressed themselves very well indeed?
I wouldn't agree with that, no. I think that Gaitskell and Heath expressed themselves extremely well. In fact, only too well. You might say that the fault with Gaitskell and the fault with Heath is that they expressed themselves with such straightforwardness and such vigour. And Gaitskell wanted to revolutionise the Labour Party and scrap Clause 4. Heath wanted to revolutionise England. And what did he say? Like Israeli England is a very difficult country to move. He wanted to take us into the common market, who did. And he was blunt and tough. You see, Ted Heath's difficulties with the trade unions were reflected in his difficulties with the public. He dealt long and in detail with the trade unions, but very toughly and vigorously. Whereas, just on the second part of your question, Macmillan and Wilson, because you asked me a complicated but interesting question, they were the political magicians of their time, if you like, and they were also the first television prime ministers. Macmillan was the first television prime minister, and Wilson was the second. Whether they and they mastered the medium, and they were politically very successful.
Who's the most promising now? I mean, who's most worthy of your mettle now?
Well, I wouldn't put it in that way. I mean,
well, Sir John Knott has resigned virtually from that competition, but who is there?
Sir John Knott, if we may deal with that aside, which you obviously meant me to deal with. Sir John Knott was not in a very good mood that day when he walked out and didn't like my putting to him the views of Admiral Sir Henry Leach, which he showed by walking out. But that's a free country. I wouldn't talk about politicians being worthy of my mettle. As a journalist concerned with interviewing people, is one of my jobs. It is the person who has those who have the responsible positions whom one wishes to interview. It's not a question of whether they're worthy. As far as I'm concerned, if they're in charge, if they have a responsibility, then that is my responsibility if I'm given it. But I haven't, in fact, done any political interviewing, as it happens, for some time. So you're really talking about past history. Half your audience probably wondering why they've never seen me doing a political interview.
So you feel it's too long since you've done a political interview?
I don't know that it's too long. Probably just about the right length for a lot of people, but I haven't, in fact, interviewed the Prime Minister, Mrs. Thatcher, for over 3 years, and I haven't done a major political interview for almost as long, a couple of years perhaps. This is partly because my question time has been regarded as my main output, and for all sorts of other reasons. But that's how it's happened. These things come and go, as you know.
Well, speaking of what I would regard as only the recent past, which politician has been most difficult to get hold of, most slippery in answering your question?
I wouldn't dream of using the word slippery about anybody, because that would be insulting. On the contrary, the people who are most difficult to interview are really the people who are most interesting to interview. For instance, someone like Enoch Powell, because if one just lets slip one little single syllable word which is inaccurate factually in the interview, this is taken up, turned around and thrown at you. So you have to be very careful. But on the other hand, he responds to a logical sequence of questions and enjoys it. I think the the most difficult person to interview are the, and both the Prime Minister and Mrs. Thatcher and Miss Michael Foot are like that. They know that the longer they keep going, the more they can get across, so they make it very difficult to interrupt.
Have you ever damaged a politician's reputation?
Not as far as I know, and indeed the whole illusion of the interviewer's reputation is that there's something called a tough interview, which is created by an interviewer. Now, this is absolute nonsense. I can remember interviews which I've spent all day trying to think of difficult questions. And the interviewer smiled throughout and said, thank you very much. I'm most grateful to you, Robin, for asking me that question. Well, nowadays, if they want to be even more unctuous, they say, Sir Robin, how nice it was to be interviewed by you again. On the other hand, I put some innocent question, which is more or less the equivalent of what's the time. And the person can blow his top and everyone says, what a brutal interview. It's the interviewee who decides whether a question is tough.
Now, on the House of Commons, do you think that the broadcasting of the House of Commons is damaging to its reputation?
On the balance, yes, and I'm very distressed about this because I have advocated, as you may remember, the televising of Parliament and also the sound broadcasting for many years. In fact, I was the first person to argue the case in detail for the televising of Parliament, and I believe profoundly in that for the simple reason that if Parliament is going to remain the prime forum of national debate, it should not shut itself off from the prime medium of mass communication. I think the trouble with radio is they didn't persevere with it properly. The something about the way the sound of Parliament, disembodied sound of Parliament, which makes it sound quite different from it really is. Now you hear the noisy question time or the noisy exchanges. You are not aware of it seeming like a bear garden when you are there, because people are sitting there in sober suits and they're smiling at one another and they're saying nonsense like this. And it's just a lively meeting.
So that's an argument for televising it. Do you think television would explain it?
Oh, yes, indeed.
And do you think we've got any chance of getting it?
Well, that is for Parliament to decide. And I think it is inevitable. I think it is like the tide coming in. The tide may go out from time to time, but it'll come in and go through.
But apart from Prime Minister's Question Time, say, and Budget Day, do you think the public would really watch?
Oh, yes, indeed, because as you know very well, there are many occasions other than Prime Minister's Question Time. For instance, ministerial statements on questions. For instance, today, as we speak, before this interview is actually seen, there will be a statement in the House of Commons, so we're told, about Mr. McGregor's appointment to be chairman of the coal board. I think it may be, whether it's the Prime Minister or Mr. Nigel Lawson, the Energy Secretary, there will be some very good rough exchanges, and interesting exchanges and important exchanges, lasting perhaps for half an hour or 45 minutes. The other question is, it isn't so much a question of whether the public would really like it or want it. It is a question of whether it should be available to those members of the public who want it. And if I may remind you that you can create demand and create interest. In 1939, there was no news at 6 and 7 and 8 o'clock in the morning because we hadn't then gone to war. But as soon as you went to war, you had news at 6 and 7 and 8 in the morning. And if you took it away now, people wouldn't like it.
Do you think television can go everywhere? I mean, would you take it into courts of law as they do in the United States?
No.
Why not?
Because I think this raises questions of unfairness to individuals, such as the accused person. I mean, I think if a person is accused of a crime and he's innocent under our system until he is proved guilty, there are very, very grave considerations involved in allowing that person, say, for 3 weeks to have his face on the screen as someone who is, in the minds of the public, probably guilty, but not in the minds of the jury. And I think this raises difficulties, but it's a complicated question.
In your long television career, who do you take advice from? I mean, do you know yourself when you finished a programme that you've done well or not so well? Who do you rely on?
Well, of course, my wife is a very a highly intelligent critic. One has close friends, both in the profession and out, who can be counted on to give a frank opinion. But if I may say so, I have a rough idea afterwards, and I say to myself, I know I didn't do that well. But Perhaps the real test comes over the period of, we're talking about a programme which perhaps has a lot of attention to it. Over the period of the next fortnight, one gets a very accurate impression from talking to people in shops and on buses. Don't forget, as you know, people come up and talk to you about it. You can sense that a programme has had created a good impression from a variety of people. They praise it in a way which they don't praise it if it was a lousy programme. They say, saw you the other night, and you say, any good? They say, yes, I enjoyed it, you see. But if they come up to you and say, by goodness me, that was an interesting programme, you know that they're genuine.
Yes, saw you is a way of dismissing it.
That's right.
Yeah. Do you actually think you exercise any power?
No.
You're very dismissive, but just go back and think about it. You are the person who illuminates a politician, illuminates his policy. Do you not have a very considerable power in your job?
Well, you see, my answer is no, and for the reason that you made a fundamental mistake in that question. You said you are the person. I'm not the person. I'm one of a number of people. You are one of them. There's Brian Walden. There's all sorts of people. There's Anna Ford and Selena Scott and all sorts of well-known celebrities doing current affairs programmes. I'm only one of them. Now, even taking me alone, first of all, I don't interview anybody unless I'm asked to interview them. There's no such thing as a Robin Day subpoena. Well, there's an Alastair Burnet something to which I responded with alacrity today, I only interview some because a BBC producer says interview him, and of course I have to interview them within the accepted parameters of what the programme is about.
Now, what you are saying now means really the truth about you. You are a much nicer and more modest man than many politicians or many people watching you interview politicians would imagine. Did you actually construct somebody called Sir Robin Day?
No, but you're quite right. I mean, it is perfectly true that I'm a very nice, warm and wonderful human being, whereas a lot of people think I'm an unpleasant bastard. I mean, it's the absolute reverse, if I may say so, with yourself. I mean, you are, everyone thinks you're rather nice, but in fact, when one gets to know you, well, I don't want to take that.
But it's good there's something different about us, isn't it, Rob?
I don't want to take that too far. No, I admire you very greatly and hold you in the very highest respect. What was your question?
Well, the question is, when did you actually set about the cruel glasses, the bow tie and the manner?
Oh, well, let's take the glasses. I've worn glasses since I was 14 because I was short-sighted. That point number one. Bow ties. I wore a bow tie long before I ever went into television. When I was a student, my father taught me how to wear a bow tie. A bow tie is just something I wore, never thinking anything about it. I only wore a bow tie on television because I came in wearing it one day, and one of the ladies in the ITN newsroom, a rather conventional lady, whom we both know and whose name I won't mention, came up to me and said, "You can't wear a bow tie for the news, Robin." And I immediately said, well, obviously, I must wear a bow tie for the news, and then it seems...
It's not obligatory, of course.
No, no, it's not obligatory, but it saves time. And, of course, a bow tie has four ends to it, you see, which you could tie it four ways instead of one, like that, you see. You didn't know that, did you?
No, I'm a tram and you're a bus. I have that. Now, instead of breaking your bones,
yes,
unfortunately, you were to break your neck. What would you like people to say of you?
Assuming that the breaking of the neck was fatal?
I'm afraid so. For the purposes of this question...
It isn't necessarily fatal.
No, no, but it could be terminal.
What
would you like? What epitaph would you like? Have you written yours? Have you written your obituary for the Times yet?
I personally haven't, no.
Have you looked over it?
No, I haven't. I'm not the sort of person to whom such a privilege would be given. What do I want people to say of me? I hope that they will say he made people laugh and he tried to help them understand their responsibilities in a democracy.
Now, that's very good. What does ambition hold for you now? Is there another step? Question Time is a new programme for you. Brought out a different side to you.
Well, they couldn't think of anything else to do with me, so I gave me Question Time.
Oh, come on, they think of other things to do, radio, phone-ins at election time.
I don't know whether we'll get those because of breakfast television. No, it's all very different. I don't know. Do you know, I've never been one to, and don't sort of reach for your sick bag. I've never been very ambitious at all. I have grasped the opportunities which have been offered to me. When you say, what is your next step? I don't know. I mean, there might be a phone call waiting for me when I get home. I was rather hoping that when I came here, perhaps you might be making a proper proposition to me of some kind or another.
This is a very good time for all the agents and all the producers to be watching.
Do you think the breakfast television would be suitable for me?
I'm sure they're on the phone already. Thank you very much.